This is Maker Galaxy.
We're always talking about the future of design, the future of technology, the future of making. In a world where Legos have become a prototyping tool for building robots in your living room. A world where you can carry a 3D printing pen in your pocket. How do we find the next big thing? MakerGalaxy is a show that explores the crossroads of design, technology, and the future of making. Welcome to the show, everybody. I'm your host, Simon Martin, and this week we talked with Mr. Brooks Myers, founder of the mobile 3D scanning company Knockout Concepts. After a short career in the time-based media field in Los Angeles, Brooks returned to his industrial design roots to create a mobile 3D scanner that allows everybody from casual users to professional designers capture the world around them. We'll talk with Brooks about everything from how working in a different industry helped him rediscover his roots as a designer, how he even began the process of creating a 3D scanner, to why he thinks we're on the cusp of a 3D scanning boom. Today's episode is brought to you by the new Objet 500 Connex 3 from Stratasys, the world's only color and multi-material 3D printer. Offering incomparably brilliant and consistent colors, plus transparent colors, the Objet 500 Connex 3 lets you create the most true-to-life modeling possible. Find out more at Stratasys.com. Welcome, Brooks. First, we want to know, where can we find the best sushi spot on earth, and what should we get there?
Well, there's a place here in Columbus, Ohio called Sushi King that I haven't been to, but my hardware engineer, John Lawson, tells me you can get a pretty amazing crunchy California roll there.
Crunchy California roll. I love California rolls, so
yeah.
I'll have to check that out when I'm in Columbus.
That's right.
Now, we'll get into Knockout Concepts in a couple minutes, but before we do, can you tell us a little bit about your background and who you are, Brooks?
Sure. Well, I grew up in Ohio, in the country, so I was running around in the nature most of my days as a little guy, and kind of always was hands-on learning, wanted to be creative at every turn, and so eventually, I was led to art school in Columbus, Ohio, went to CCAD, and always had a lot of intrigue towards hardware. So video game console hardware and 3D graphics kind of started to grab a hold of me, and I wanted to go into industrial design. So that seemed like the best place for me. Out of college, though, I didn't really apply my design and went into the television world out in Los Angeles. I did some time-based media studies to go along with my industrial design, and that led me out to LA, and I got sidetracked working on Judge Judy and Deal or No Deal and some other TV shows when I was out there, but it gave me, you know, it gave me more reason to make my own products and do my own thing and move back towards the design and the hardware that I loved so much. So when I was out in LA, I kind of had a light bulb moment, I guess you could say.
Definitely. And so what you mentioned, you worked with Judge Judy and Deal or No Deal. What exactly were you doing there? And did the light bulb moment happen on set?
I can't say that it happened on set so much, but I was running around doing a little bit of everything for the production companies. We were filming Judge Judy and Judge Joe Brown, and I was doing a lot of running around. I was a production assistant at the time, and just driving around Los Angeles a lot, hanging out on the set. And from there, I just worked on a bunch of TV shows. But I guess part of the work in the television gave me this vision that okay, so a lot of these TV shows are maybe kind of ridiculous ideas. Some of them don't last very long. Judge Judy is an anomaly in that case. But somehow these projects are getting funded.
Yeah.
A large amount of people and a large amount of talent are all coming together to make these projects real and to get them live. And that kind of inspired me, because I was like, I got this sense of almost anything is possible as long as you just go for it. That was really part of what kind of inspired me.
Definitely. Okay, so you were inspired by seeing these massive productions take shape every week, and that inspired you to start your own company. And so how did you make that jump from being in LA to coming back to Columbus and creating a company? And ultimately, what product did you create?
Okay, so when I was out in LA, I guess I had this idea, and the idea took over. And at that point, I was really, trying to plug in as best I could in LA to various clubs and gatherings and any kind of social event or industry event related to 3D. There's a great club out there called the Stereo Club of Southern California, which is not 3D graphics as much as it is stereoscopy and 3D film and 3D photography. But there's a lot of industry individuals that have made their living for, just 3D. And so it was cool to plug into these kind of events. But when the idea took over, I realized if I didn't do this, somebody else would. And I had to move. I had to move out of there. The rent was excessive, and I wanted to kind of get away from working in the television shows, which oftentimes can be 12-hour days, depending upon, if the show is new or not. And that led me back to Ohio, where, I think some shifts have happened in the past 3 years that make a technology company in the Midwest, hardware, software, Kickstarter, Indiegogo, all of these things are just way more plausible than they were a few years back. So when I was out there, I didn't really expect that, the best thing would be to come back here, but it all just kind of happened that way and worked just fine.
And so from then, what was the golden idea, and how did you put that in motion?
Okay, so the golden idea was to create a 3D capturing camera device of sorts. That's how it started. Napkin sketches, tons of sketches everywhere all over my house of a concept for capturing 3D files, and also ideas of how people would utilize that, how they would work with it, how they would visualize those things.
Definitely.
What does this device look like? I mean, of course, coming from an industrial design background, you get pretty nerdy about just like sketching out forms. And, how does the human interface with the form, and what is this thing really? But it was only a couple years later, I would say, well, maybe 3 years later, when the company was formed in 2012. And we focused on making a all-in-one mobile 3D scanner with an excellent user experience. And we considered it a tool. It's a creative tool. It helps people capture 3D files. And I think that's an important thing. It's getting more and more attention lately. And I think 3D printers have some to do with that.
So, okay, with that being said, what separates it from other 3D scanners, such as the Sense from 3D Systems?
Okay, so a product like that is great in that it's hitting a pretty good price point. I think it's like $399 or $499 or something. What we have done differently from a product like that is cut the cord.
Yeah.
There's always been an aspect about what we do that is cord cutting. We don't want you to have to plug something that has a cord into your laptop. Because now your laptop, it's just not mobile anymore. As soon as you're doing that, it's not mobile. The whole package itself you can take from point A to point B and set it up and scan something there, but you really can't, you can't really crawl around and get into tight spaces with something like that. And you're always tethered to the machine. So with ours, we've slapped a screen and everything into an all-in-one package. So you turn this thing on, it's built from the ground up to be a mobile 3D scanner, and you can take it to your environment, you can take it to your subject matter, and not the other way around, where something like a sense, yeah, it's somewhat mobile and you can take it to your subject matter, but even worse, things like the desktop turntables, while they may do a little bit higher quality scan, you're bringing the object to be scanned to the scanner. And that just is wholly different than what we are focusing on in enabling people to take the scanner into the field and where they need to go to capture what they need to capture.
So you're developing both the hardware and software, correct?
That's correct.
Okay, so what do you think is going to be the most technically challenging part of the user experience for the average user with getting up and running with 3D scanning, like, you know, with the rise of consumers using 3D printers? How is it going to be, how are they just going to jump into this 3D scanning activity, or how are they going to adopt that into what they're trying to do? What are they going to use it for?
Well, okay. So I think, you know, part of what we are solving is that this problem already exists. You know, I mean, it's already been somewhat hard for the general consumer to understand. I think they've been kind of bombarded with the word 3D since 2010-ish, I think, is when consumer electronics show, 3D TVs, you know, ESPN 3D, and everything in between. I think 3D is a little bit tricky for people to understand. The 3D printers is probably the best thing, because they understand that 3D files are CAD software equals tangible object when printed out on a 3D printer in plastics. You know, coming from a design background, that is speaking our language, and we totally get it. But we also understand there's a lot of people out there that's not an easy connection for them. I mean, people's minds are being blown every day still about 3D printers. When they see them, when they first hear about them, I'm sure you've experienced it many times yourself, where you see the reaction and people just like light up and they start like bombarding you with ideas they have.
Right.
But so the 3D education side is hard, but when you see all the other things that are out there, what we're trying to provide is an out of the box experience. So you have everything you need when you open the box, and it's an exciting device. So it's like getting, you know, the old Nintendo when you were a kid for the first time and pulling it out of the box and setting it up in the living room. I mean, you're excited about it. It's everything you need is in that box. You get it out and you can just turn it on.
Totally.
And start to jump into the 3D space, start to work in the 3D medium. And so I think that, you know, what people are going to be using this for is really hard to say, but I imagine that to start with, it's going to be a lot like a camera, where you're just capturing 3D files left and right. And are you using all of them? Probably not. You know, I would say average person's iPhone is sitting there with a ton of photos on it that they really have no plan to do anything with, but they snapped it.
Right.
And so I think it starts there. Just getting people to capture 3D files. And I think that there will be a slight learning curve with that. People will get better at it. They'll understand how to do a better scan as they get into this thing. But we're going to provide everything on the screen so that you can do even editing right there on the device itself, send the files to a 3D printer if you want to print them. But we also realize that printing is only one aspect of 3D files, and that there is many, many uses for 3D files that are only in the digital space.
Okay, so what is the product called, and is it available right now?
So internally, we refer to the product as Firefly. It is not currently available. We have demoed it. We have multiple prototypes of it. It is being fleshed out right now and retooled for a version 2, which would be coming to Kickstarter, undisclosed time, but soonish. And so it's the Firefly.
Awesome. And then you mentioned the prototyping. What can you tell us a little bit about your process of creating the prototype? I mean, what were some of the challenges that you found in creating a 3D scanner that you might not have expected?
Okay, well, you know, we knew from the start that it was going to be very challenging and that this was not just an easy project. And, of course, we looked at what else was out there. At the time, it was all industrial, very, very expensive. And so we wanted to look at what parts existed, what reference design parts, what dev kits were out there for the electronics that we could start to mock this thing up, just build a quick shoebox prototype, get something working that did what we wanted it to do. And we got that down into a pretty sexy package, which we could 3D print an enclosure for, which you can see the image of said device, the Firefly, on our website. And it took the form of kind of like a chunky tablet, or almost like even what do they call that? A Wii, what is the Wii U game pad or whatever it is, you know?
Yeah.
Like it looks kind of like that. It has a 7-inch screen on the front. We had to source all these parts from Korea and everywhere else. And we built this device from the ground up. So there were a lot of challenges in that. That being said, we built a team. I built a team of guys of discipline experts. So there's somebody on our team that has an answer for everything. We have an industrial designer dedicated to making sure the enclosure fits around the electronics properly and that there are vents for heat dispersion and everything like that. So, you know, we did a pretty polished job for our first prototype. And so I think that's what makes it look even that much more market ready. You get a lot of people asking, well, you know, how much is it? Where can I get it? And it's not there yet, Simon, but we're getting closer to that point.
So do you have an estimated Kickstarter launch date, like sometime in 2014?
Yes. Yeah. We're looking at this year being a good time to go to Kickstarter. And we haven't actually even chosen Kickstarter for sure. We have some friends with projects on Indiegogo that are really happy, and we'll just have to see how it plays out.
Well, that brings up another interesting point. As somebody who's kind of on the cusp of doing a crowdfunding launch, where do you see the benefits of Kickstarter outweighing Indiegogo and vice versa?
Well, it's really pretty hard for me to say. I think at first it started out with Kickstarter having this bigger profile, maybe, you know, on the internet, or where their presence is maybe more known than Indiegogo or something like that. And clearly, I don't know for sure what the benefit would be between one or the other, besides just their models are slightly different. They take a little bit of a different cut. The Indiegogo allows you to keep all of your money if you don't hit your funding goal, all of those kinds of little things. And I'm sure that each of these sites in and of themselves have reputations. And so you kind of take all of those things into consideration, I guess, is the way we're going at it. But who knows? I mean, the fun thing about these types of crowdfundings, you can jump in. If you fail, you can jump back in again. I mean, it's really pretty great. It's fun to watch what things catch on fire, you know?
Definitely.
Like whatever, that new cube or that little 3D printer that just came out, made over $1 million already. And there's just so many that just, you don't know which ones or why, but seems like if you have the right package, they're bound to just blow up.
Definitely. And so once you have this final product out there, are you going to have some sort of like a hub for these 3D scan products and environments that you think the users will kind of pull from and upload to?
Yeah. And yes, we do have a plan for that. We've talked about it since the beginning of, okay, we're going to give a device and a software to anybody who wants it to be able to let them capture these files. Where are they going to put them? Are they just going to store them internally? Is there going to be a hub of sorts? And yeah, the hub makes a lot of sense. But there are people out there making the hub. There are companies out there that are making the hub. You know, I think one of the first things that came out was Thingiverse and all these other things like Sketchfab. And some of them are for sharing just the digital file, like Sketchfab. And others of them, like Visua, are there to let you download the printable. And so that's, you know, it depends what you're going for. Sketchfab is great for just being able to visualize and embed any kind of 3D model on the web. Visua, on the other hand, is more like what you're talking about with a hub where people can go capture files, upload files, and download files, maybe even for a fee. You know, if I upload a file that I really like and I want to make a small amount of coin off of it, maybe I could. So there's so many little things, and then you get into copyrighted and intellectual property for design patents. You know, we don't want people to just be scanning, you know, known forms that are already protected and enable them to do things with them illegally. So there's so many ins and outs with that and legal implications that gets pretty fun to work with. But really, we just want people to be able to capture, you know, organic shapes. When we look at what is, you know, different between CAD and scanning, I think that's probably the big difference is CAD is gets a lot trickier when you want to make organic forms. And the scanner can fill in that part for you. You know, CAD is great when you've got, you know, pretty basic shapes and nothing that's a little, you know, time consuming. You've got a lot of time that you're going to put in to sitting in front of your computer, and we're trying to reduce that. We're trying to take that away. We've had people come to us and ask us for our scanner because of that. They already have scanners in their workflow, and they use CAD and lots of digital tools daily. But for certain use cases, it makes a lot more sense to just use our all-in-one device and cut all of your overhead of time spent sitting in front of a screen trying to tweak something when you could have just quickly shaved it up in, you know, in your garage and not spent that much time doing, you know, all the digital design work.
Okay, and so these people who were seeking out prototypes from you, what exactly were they wanting to use them for? I mean, is it kind of foreshadowing where you see your market going? What exactly were they wanting to do?
Most of it is for creating off of a plan of something that already exists, that they want to either make something that is custom fitted for something that already exists, or they want to build something off of something old. So, for instance, we've had some furniture makers interested. They are typically using photos, and they're trying to take photos of old period furniture and capture as many angles as they can so that they can take those photos back to their workshop and kind of lay all the photos out and look at and then sketch out, you know, these old furnitures, which don't have any plans. There's no drawings. There's no technical drawings anywhere of this old period furniture. But there's new craftsmen who want to make furniture in this style. So I had a great guy approach me about that. And he was saying, wow, I love this. I love the scanner. I would just be able to scan my chair, take that information back to my workshop, and so much more information is available to him without having to take, you know, however many 20, 25 photos of the chair that he wants to go back to his workshop and build. He can just take one scan of it and spin that scan around and look at it from different angles, and it's all right there. And that much easier for him to go ahead and build this chair based on this old school design. For custom fitting, though, there's a huge, huge space for custom fitting. Even if you have, for instance, some fragile object that you wanted to scan and you want to put it in a box to ship it, you can easily do a scan of the object and then have a router come down and core out your foam block that is designed specifically for the object you want to ship. And now you've got a custom box. You've got lots of use cases like orthotics and things for us to wear. I mean, how many people, you know, go and buy insoles and different things like that? You can easily scan your foot, get custom insoles. Clothing is a big thing. With, you know, people who, I think there's been some pretty great articles, maybe even some TED Talks about this, but, you know, people have lost limbs and different things, which they could easily get a scan of their arm or leg and create a better fitting orthotic or, you know, prosthetic. And this is pretty exciting stuff when you can start to augment the human body with products that we can design in our own homes. We can get creative about building our own exoskeletons. I mean, it's kind of cool when you start to think about, if you really do tinker with these tools as they come more and more to the consumer level. I mean, it does take a creative mind, but I think that that's just human nature. You know, we always are down to like get our hands on some stuff, especially if there's not a huge barrier to entry.
Right.
That's what we've been about since the get-go, is let's cut the cord, let's reduce the barrier to entry, let's make it fun to use. And this is a new product category. I think, you know, I kind of want to set the record straight about how much activity is going on in the world of technology. I swear an idea is fresh until two or three people do it. And then all the general consumers on the blogs and everything are just like, oh, we've seen this before and that kind of thing. And it's I don't think that this is quite even a teenaged technology in the consumer space. I mean, these 3D printers and 3D scanners haven't really come into their own yet. And so we hope to really provide an experience to the consumer that, and the prosumer, that that shows them why this matters and why this is going to be a new product category that is here to stay.
Awesome.
This is definitely a tool you want in your toolbox.
Awesome. And one last question for you, Brooks. With all of your experience in developing this product, what is one piece of advice you could give our listeners to persevere through these little challenges along the way and really push on getting that final product out there?
Well, I would say, you know, do what you love. The passion, I think, is what's driven me. And so if you don't really love something and have a good grip on your idea and what you're going for, you're probably going to burn out. But surround yourself with people who share in that passion, and that's what I think ultimately will make it happen. Can't do everything yourself.
Well, Brooks, thank you so much for your time today, and great work on the scanner.
Thank you very much, Simon.
Today's episode was brought to you by the new Objet 500 Kinex 3 from Stratasys, the world's only color and multi-material 3D printer. Offering incomparably brilliant and consistent colors, plus transparent colors, the Objet 500 Kinex 3 lets you create the most true-to-life modeling possible. Find out more at Stratasys.com. Thanks for listening in today, and if you'd like to find out more about Brooks and Knockout Concepts, be sure to check them out at knockoutconcepts.com. On our next episode, we'll be talking with Kyle Studstill of the designer and maker-inspired magazine, Makeway. I'm your host, Simon Martin. Stay tuned and check in with us next week on Maker Galaxy.
A production of EBD Media.